Hey folks, welcome to another Triple T Thursday. For those just joining us, that's Tools, Tips, and Talk, where we'll discuss info for the knife maker. In today's episode, we're going to rebuild the ribbon burner for my forge. It took a little crap on me, so I'll show you some pictures of that, but let's get right into how to build a ribbon burner.
Okay, so let's talk about a ribbon burner and how to make one. So I'm remaking this ribbon burner because my last one cracked. I'll show you a picture in the corner of what happened, but it kind of cracked down the center. So I'm really just remaking this, but all this is a 3-inch square tube, okay, with the ends welded on it. So this has just been a cap welded on either side, and then this has been cut out here. And it's important to leave a little lip here. And I'll explain why when we get into, when we actually pour the refractory in the center. On the inside, this is a thin, I don't know what gauge that is, like 16th inch or whatever, just a sheet of steel with some holes drilled into it, with no holes kind of right here, because you want it to disperse the gas evenly, because if you don't put this here, just all the holes in the center will get all the gas. So this is kind of at a V like this. So when the air hits it, it goes down. So I don't know if you guys see that. You probably don't, but it's at a little V here. So that's really all there is to the burner. I put this flange on it just so it would sit on the forge level. I didn't want to play with little thumb screws, but I know other people have done that. And then there's just a flange, a coupling, just welded on the top so that I could screw in whatever size piping you want. I think this is 1 1/4 inch, but you can use 2 inch. It just depends. You're just going to need more air, a bigger fan if the bigger orifice you need. And when you get into big burners, you want to be able to deliver more gas. So that's the burner. It's very easy to make. If you know how to weld, they're really trivial. So let's talk about how we're going to make this. So I have a mold here that I'm going to make, which this fits perfectly into, and I'm going to obviously screw this together. But that's going to be our mold. Okay, the bottom, and I've just, I put this on and I just drew an outline here. What we're going to use is plastic straws. I've seen some guys use crayons, but then you got to drill out the crayons. I just think it's easier to use straws. You'll see why. You could just pull them out with pliers after, so really simple. How do you know how many holes you should put? I've had people question me on this. What you do is cut up all your straws, however many you think you need. And then really all you're going to do is take your straws and fit them into the pipe. Okay? And that's, so I'm not going to stuff them all in there, but that's how many straws fit in the pipe. That's how many holes you should have. If you put I dropped a straw in there. If you put too many straws, too many holes in the burner, it's like you're, when the air hits it, it's kind of slowing down, and you don't want that. You want the same volume space so that this isn't opening up. And if you have too few, then you're funneling all the air. So that's the best way to know how to do it. I also like to use the big straws, the McDonald's size straws, if you know what that means. And I have 22 of these. So I'm going to have a configuration of 7 holes, 8 holes, 7 holes. And you want to have these kind of equidistant. So do some math, figure out where your holes are going to go. And what I'm going to do is drill a 1/4 inch hole for each one of the straws. And I'm just going to sit them in there.
I'll make this easy on you. If you know how many holes you have and you know the distance, just divide that by the holes plus 1. So if you got 7 holes, divide by 8, and then just put that on your calipers and measure.
Okay, I've got the stop set on my drill. I've got, I think this is a 5/16 drill bit, which is exactly what the straws will fit in and still be a tiny bit snug. So let's get drilling.
And you don't have to be hyper accurate here, folks. You can be off by a 16th or so. It's not going to matter.
Okay, I've got the mold all screwed together. I've got all my straws placed in the holes. And don't worry about them being, like, if they seem a little floppy, because as soon as you start putting the refractory in it, it'll fill between them, and then you can just reposition them, and they'll be rock solid by the time you get the refractory up to the top. Now, the reason you want a lip here is the refractory is going to go past that lip here. So this will actually give you, like, an anchor. So that's why you want that lip there, so that it's really solid and you don't just have kind of refractory butted up against this and it can slip out or crack or whatever. I'm using green cast 94 refractory. This is probably one of the highest temp refractories. It's rated to 3400 degrees and it's super solid. Not necessarily, I think, the best heat at retaining heat, but this is going to be for, like, this is going to be better than concrete. So I want a really solid burner that's not going to crack. So this stuff should be really, really solid. So I got a mixing bucket, my rebar mixing stick. We're going to mix some refractory and pour it in. There we go. Now, let's see if we can carefully pour this without getting it everywhere. Oh, we forgot one thing. In order to get the straws out, we're just going to coat them in WD-40.
Pouring this at the beginning can be a little tricky, but once you get a little bit in, then it's a little easier because the straws tend to stick. It's important to vibrate it to get all the air bubbles out.
All right, now that it's all arranged, we're going to carefully put this in without disrupting any of the straws. I got it. Then we're going to vibrate it again just to make sure it gets under that lip. All right. Now we just let it sit. Okay, it's been 48 hours. I'm going to pull the forms off of this. I've already taken the screws out. Let's see how we did. Yeah, feels solid. You can see all the straws sticking out. Hopefully those come off nice and easy. Oh wow, this stuff's really cool. It's like plaster. That one doesn't want to come out as easy. I'm still being a little gentle with this because it's not fully cured yet. Taking the forms off will actually make it cure a little faster. There it goes. Whoa! All right. And now I should be able to just pull these. Oh yeah, see how easy they come out? Well, I spoke too soon. It came out part way. There.
The last time I did this, the straws came out a little easier. I probably used more WD-40.
All right, I guess I'll burn the other three out. There's three stuck in there, but that's fine. I'm sure the heat will take them out. It's pretty solid. It's much more solid than the Mizu was last time I used it. So far, so good. Okay, I'm ready to light it. I let it dry for another 2 days, and now I've hooked it all up. I actually test fired it already, but we're gonna put it inside the forge. We'll see how it does. So I had that running at the tank around 10 PSI, but I want to explain something to you guys that I made a mistake on, and I'm sure many people do when they're quoting the pressure on a ribbon burner. And you hear people say, oh, I'm running my ribbon burner at 1 PSI. Really? Okay, that's not a good measurement, and I'll tell you why. Because they're measuring pressure. That's pressure. How much pressure the tank is giving out. Well, there's a lot of factors there. On a normal Venturi burner, you're using a MIG tip, which has a very small orifice, like a 30 thousandths orifice. So if the tank pressure is at 10 PSI, it's pushing it through that tiny hole. It's building up a lot of pressure against that gauge. Here, I've got a 3/16 hole going in the gas going into the line. So that's affording a lot less pressure. So when I'm pushing, feels like 1 PSI, that's because it's not pushing very much pressure against the orifice. Okay, the tank is still open just as much. So really what you would need to measure is the flow rate. Okay. You can say, oh, I'm only using 1 PSI of pressure. That's not really true. You're using the same amount of gas. So the easy way to measure this is if you have one of these switch off valves, one of these disconnect valves, when it's running the way you want it, okay, turn this off. Then go look at your pressure gauge. Okay, so right now the pressure gauge reads 10 PSI when this is off. Meaning it's pushing against, solidly against, so there's no orifice at all because it's closed. And when I did the same thing on the Venturi burner at what I needed, what I thought was about the same amount of heat, it was at about 15 PSI. Okay. Also, when I'm running this, I've got this needle valve 3/4 closed. Okay. So that's also affecting the pressure. So less gas is going through because of the needle valve. So I'm guessing I'm running this probably around, I'm guessing around 4 PSI. Equivalent, 4 PSI equivalent as if I was running on Venturi. Maybe 5. Okay, but people that say, oh, I'm running a half PSI or 1 PSI, you're not. It's because the orifice leading to it is so much bigger. So folks, I made this mistake of quoting these kinds of numbers. They're not accurate. Unless you have a really expensive flow meter, they're a couple $100, you're not getting what you think you are. But I'm really happy with this. Like I said, I'm probably running it around 5 PSI to get it up to welding heats. And it's running really well. So it's basically back up to where I had it. Now, I will be building another forge soon. I'll show you guys the cylinder I'm going to use from a buddy.
who's a welder, who gave me this big 18 inch piece of pipe. I like this forge. The only problem with it is it's got a lot of interior space. And I did do that on purpose. I knew what I was getting into. It just takes a long time to heat up. And this burner is only 8 inches long. And the forge is 18. So there's 5 inches on either side of the burner. They're a little colder spots than I wish they were. So what I'm going to do, that one's going to be 18 inches. It's going to be cylindrical. It's going to have a much smaller, this is probably only going to be 4.5. I don't need all this space, so it's probably only going to be about 4.5, the size of one brick, and it'll be about the same height. So if I do rough it, it'll roughly be about 1.5 inches narrower, so it'll take out a lot of space, plus the burner will be, it's probably going to have the same air system. I might put a heavier fan on it, but the burner is going to be narrower and longer. So it's going to be a full 2 inches longer on either side. So just so I can get a more even heat all through the forge instead of having kind of a hot spot in the center. But the forge still works great. I can still forge weld in it. Obviously, you've seen me make a lot of Damascus in it. But ribbon burner's definitely the way to go. You'll get more even heat. They're super cheap to make. I described it. Made it in a, literally, I probably made it in 45, like not including the fabrication on this guy, which probably took an hour. In total, you can probably make yourself a ribbon burner in about 2 hours. So I would encourage everyone, switch to force air. It is definitely the way to go. You'll definitely get at least a 50% increase in your gas. At least, especially if you're running like the big 2-3 burner forges, you're going to be running at least half the gas, probably a little better. So thanks for joining me on today's Triple T, folks. Hope you got something out of it. We'll see you on the next one.